I will start with a very brief introduction of what ITI is, and I will stop in a particular slide where I will tell my story of my interaction with Maria, and then I will present her activities during this period. So, this is just a slide showing that ITI was established first as a laboratory at the Aristotle University of Thessaloniki in the Electrical Engineering Department, and then became a part of CERTH as the Information Technology Institute. Actually, it was called Informatics and Telematics Institute for some period. And it had six main research activities. This is why am I showing this slide? Just to show you that all these activities are mainly activities which were driven by the work of the colleagues that were initially members of the lab at the university. So we were all influenced by our first, the founder of the institute and the first director of the institute, Professor Stringes. So when Maria came, she found a situation which was mainly driven by the research areas that Professor Stringes had in the past. And this is the slide where I would like to stay. So she came at ITI in 2008. She was elected as the director of ITI in 2008. And of course, we had a long period where our director was Professor Stringes. And as I told you, all the research areas were mainly influenced by that. This is just to give you some historical information so that you understand that when she came, it was a big change for us, for the researchers, for the people that were working at ITI. It was a big change. We always knew that our director was Professor Stringes, and we had to accept that we have a new director now, Professor Petrou, and start interacting with her. I'm also presenting the facts from my point of view. So, just to remind you that Maria joined ITI also 2 years ago, I think in 2006, and on a sabbatical for just 6 months. So she had some kind of a trial period of trying to see how things are working in Greece. She always believed that we are far behind the UK system, and in most of the cases she was right, and she's still right, that Greece, in terms of research, may be some steps behind from other European countries. So, saying that, I would just like to add another issue on the presentation of the scientific activity and the life of Maria, which is mainly that I believe that when she was in Imperial, I think she wanted to come back to Greece. She wanted to find a reason, to find a good position in Greece, and especially in Thessaloniki, because we all know that she was born in Thessaloniki, and she wanted to find a very good reason to come back to Greece. I know her son was already in Thessaloniki, and she wanted to start a new life in Thessaloniki. For personal reasons, and I would say that she knew what ITI is, and also for scientific reasons. She believed that she would do her job very well in ITI. And honestly speaking, in these 4 years that she worked with us, I think the last 2-3 years, except the first year, which was actually she was trying to find her way in the Greek way of thinking, I think she was happy. I think she was happy being a director at CERTH-ITI. And I will come back to this with my presentation. So she joined ITI as a director in October 2008 after a competitive international open call and evaluation. And just I would like to make another note here that there was a new procedure at CERTH in this period that the directors, the candidate directors, had to make a presentation to the staff before they present their work to the committee. So we had the presentation for all the candidates. And I think, Yanni, you remember that after her presentation, we said, wow, this is exactly what we are looking for. This is a perfect presentation. Because we have heard about Maria that she's a very difficult person to deal with, and she's demanding a lot from her colleagues. This was a rumor that we had in our minds. You never know someone before you interact, you really interact with this person. So I personally changed completely my view on Maria after she became the director, and I will talk about this also later. Of course, I'm sure she didn't like very much this managerial and administrative stuff, but she had to be involved with this at ITI, and I think she was pretty successful on that. And she had her own way of thinking. She wanted to integrate educational and research activities. So she came at ITI and told us, do you have some kind of a seminar here? How are you continuously educating your staff? And we said, what? No, we never did something like that. We had some seminars, but only when some people were visiting, experts like the ones that we have today were visiting Greece, and we had the opportunity to invite them also to give a talk. And then we had this regular period of seminars, which was very helpful, I think, for the whole group. She followed an open and extrovert approach. This is something that she was herself. So she continued to act as she did in Surrey and in Imperial. She was expressing exactly what she was thinking. She was very open and very frank, and this was appreciated by everyone. And she believed that, okay, we are a research center. We were very, very successful in European projects in this period, and we are still very, very successful in these European projects. But she said, what are we giving back to the community? So let's try to at least show to the people what we are doing and what could be our contribution in the following years. Maybe we are not giving back anything now, but maybe we can do it in the following years. Another issue, when Maria Petrou came, she found out that a big problem of the Greek research area, which is that in the research institutes we are not allowed to have PhD students. So we need to have a collaboration with the university. And when Professor Stringes retired, our path to the Aristotle University of Thessaloniki became very difficult. We didn't have many options to have PhD students. So she proposed, she said, I have very good contacts with Surrey, with Imperial. Okay, there is this issue with the fees, but we can handle it. And she opened another path for us, and she managed in 3 years to initiate 9 split PhD programs, as we call them, which is actually that people are working in ITI at CERTH, and they are getting their PhD from either Surrey or India. And she expanded the areas of this PhD in, you see, of course, in signal and image processing, and the computer vision, pattern recognition, areas that she had always worked with, but also in visual analytics and event and social media analysis. So this was a great contribution for us. Without PhD students, you cannot do real research. And she offered us this opportunity. Then, some issues. We didn't have a dedicated demo room at ITI, so we were trying to present our work in our laptops. So she said, it's not possible, we need to have a special room for this. And she installed it. It was the first thing that she did when she came. Of course, she did the regular seminars and she managed it herself, so she was always there when there was a seminar. She planned it so that she will be there and she will actively participate in this discussion. She believed very much in it. And another issue having to do with our contact with the local community, she organized what we call an ITI Open Day. So one day per year where our institute was open and could be visited by anybody. Anybody. So this was a great opportunity for high school students, for cities, and also from professionals or individuals from the local business. Or the first thing she said is, why don't you invite your parents? They have to see where you are working. It's honest, my parents live in Ioannina, they don't know where I'm working. It's really strange. They have to come once and see what you are actually doing. This is, of course, an issue that we are all facing when we are trying to describe what we are doing. Not everybody really understands. Then, I will present briefly her work, her scientific work at CERTH-ITI, but we have special dedicated presentations on that later by my colleagues. And we should not forget that she had some management work, some administrative work at ITI, but she was always a researcher. She was always thinking about new ideas. She was a very open mind and dedicated to research. I think that in every part of her life, whenever she went out for dinner, she was thinking about, she was taking some snapshots of the area, she was thinking about some new ideas how to improve anything, anywhere, I would say. So she started getting acquainted with the Greek system, which is very, for the ones that don't know, is really difficult. So she understood, started to understand how things work in Greece. She established a team. So we had the existing teams at CERTH-ITI. She established her own team. And she started attracting funding from national and EU funded projects. First of all, I showed you the six areas where we were actually active in our institute. And she started some new promising research directions in remote stress sensing, biodiversity monitoring, in robotics, which is very active now in this period, and in brain cognitive processes, which is also a very, very active area at CERTH. In each of these areas, I will try to say a few words, but as I said, there will be a clear and detailed, dedicated presentation on that. So for remote sensing, you are all aware that she was active in this field from the years of Surrey. And of course, as ITI, she started joining networks of high prestige in Europe and attracting topic-related funds from the EC, from the Commission. She hired a new senior researcher, Yanis Manakos, who was specialized in remote sensing. So this is an area which is still active now at CERTH. And she started supervising PhD thesis in this area. And at this stage, this team is still active. There is a core team of excellence in this area, and there is the respective infrastructure. And we are trying to support also private sector initiatives in this area. So she left a new area, which is still active at CERTH area. She did research on biodiversity monitoring. Actually, she participated in the EU-funded research project BioSource, where she developed knowledge-based pre-operational ecological modeling system for the monitoring of Natura 2000 sites and the surrounding areas. Of course, this is very general. What she actually did is, again, textual analysis of the images, the remote sensing images. She was trying to handle missing information based on the uncertainty of data. And of course, she contributed a lot with her quality within the consortium by, of course, providing the quality assurance of all the work in the consortium. I would like to stay a little bit on this area, the robotics area. When she came, she was always, I'm sure that most of you have talked to her about this, the ironing robot. We know that many, many of the everyday issues of women have been solved. We have the washing machine, we have the dishwasher, which of course is opened new opportunities for women at home. They have to spend much less time in everyday work. But nothing has been done yet about the ironing. And she always had in her mind to develop the ironing robot, the robot that will take the clothes, make them perfect. This is what she had in her mind. So she tried to fund a European project on that, which was called Clopema. And she was doing in this project mainly photometric stereo sensing and high level perception and reasoning, with the development of a miniature photometric stereo sensor designed for close range imaging. So, what is the interesting on this is that the distance between the sensor and the surface is very close. This is the challenging aspect. And the goal was to infer the material and the properties of the material. So, because the first thing, the robot should know what kind of cloth is the one that it's handling. And she applied their the hierarchical bottom-up and top-down learning and inference framework that she had developed that was called Tower of Knowledge. It was applied mainly on garment understanding and dealing with challenges like the occlusion, deformation and articulation, and also the incorporation of action. This work has been continued by my colleague Sotiris Malasiotis, and he will present the current status of the, I wouldn't say they are in group, but I think Sotiris will explain up to what level they have reached. Concerning brain cognitive processes, she has worked a lot on 2D vector field tomography, and she wanted to extend this in 3D for understanding the cognitive process of the brain, and in particular the cognitive vision. So she applied for a program in Greek Secretariat for the Research and Technology, which was called Excellence, Aristia in Greek. And the project was called CBP, a Cognitive Signal Processing Lab. And the main target of this is to establish an infrastructure, which is actually to buy an EEG equipment for EEG supporting up to 256 channel measurements. Based on this project, a new activity has started at ITI, and this is also very, very active in this period, and Yanis Koupatsiaris is working, is continuing her work in this lab. I wanted to say that when she actually got funding for this project, it was the period where she was at the final stages at the hospital in Greece. So we had to change the scientific responsibility Maria to Yanis just after her passing away. And this also gave us the opportunity to have links with electrical engineering in the medical schools of the Aristotle University of Thessaloniki, who also participate there. And we definitely may have applications also on brain-computer interaction. So this is more or less a summary of the research activities that she had while she was at ITI. And then I want to talk now as a researcher. So, just to come back to to my initial comments and describe how she was as a director from the point of view of a researcher. So when she came, the first thing she did is she asked to see everyone working in any project at CERTH-ITI. So she met with the heads of the groups, with the core partners of the groups, and with the young programmers that had just been there. So she met everyone. Especially for the head of the groups, we went through an exhaustive screening, I would say. So she had heard about us, she had some, she had heard good things, bad things, and she wanted to test them by herself. After this period, I would say it was a period of 6 months, 1 year, she was confident that she did the right decision. That's my view, of course, which I'm expressing what I have seen. So she said, that's the right place where I can get that. These people are people that I can collaborate with. And then she started collaborating with almost all of the groups. With Yanis, with me, with Petros, with almost everyone. Another issue, that, of course, imagine our position when we had a new director and we said, and we heard she's tough, she's difficult, maybe she wants to change the structure of ITI to intervene in the work of the groups. She didn't, she never intervened in the scientific work of any of the groups, never. But she tried to contribute with technical ideas and direction during the seminars and during the everyday interaction. Apart from this, you know that we have various circumstances happening every year, and she fully supported the senior researchers of ITI whenever needed and under any circumstances. So this is very important. I cannot go into details, but we passed through different difficult situations, and she helped us a lot whenever needed. Talking now for myself, in 2012, she called me at the hospital where she was, and she said, I want to appoint you as a vice director of ITI. And she said, I want to do that because you are, I believe, I can say this now, I believe that you are a very strong person that in the board of directors of CERTH can always push a lot for the good of ITI. So she believed that I can support the position of ITI in the board of directors of CERT. Apart from the scientific work and the way I was managing the group. So she said, at least for this period, I would like you to replace me in the board of directors of CERT. This opened an opportunity for me, and that's why I then applied for being the director of ITI. So, expressing myself, the senior researchers of ITI and all the employees, I would like to tell her a very big thank you for whatever she did for us. Concluding, I would like to say I have only positive thoughts for Maria. She was a dedicated and extrovert director. Her vision resides as her legacy in the examples she set, in the work of that she left and still continuing, and infrastructure that she left. And she will always be remembered and appreciated by us and all the researchers and minds she influenced with her work and collaboration. Thank you very much.